How are we all feeling? Hopefully there's not too many sore heads in the room after the gala dinner last night. Today's session is focusing on resource monitoring. I'm sure you're all familiar with the themes of the conference by now. We have, I believe, until 12 o'clock and have five talks this morning with speakers from all over the world. And up first, we have Simon Weltersbach. Hope I pronounced that okay. Simon's talk is titled Change Points in Marine Recreational Fisheries, the Impact of Stock Status and Fisheries Regulations. And it's a case study from the Western Baltic Sea. Okay, welcome Simon, everybody.
Yes, thank you very much for the kind introduction. Let's see. Yeah, I'm going to present you a study from the Western Baltic Sea. So this is located in the northeast of Europe. And the Western Baltic Sea is bordered by Germany, Sweden, and Denmark. So we are focusing on the German part. I use this one. Just to give you some background, we have in Germany about 161,000 anglers fishing in the Baltic Sea, and they spend there about 1.2 million angling days and have expenditures of almost 250 million euros. One of the main target species of them is the Western Baltic cod. So this is actually Atlantic cod, Gadus mahua. And it's a very important recreational and commercial target species. However, in 2016, 2017, as you can see, I don't know if the pointer works, but you can see here in the plot, we had a huge decline of this cod anyway since the 1990s. But in 2016, 17, the cod cod stock collapsed more or less, and this led to the first time introduction of a bag limit in the recreational cod fishery. So this was fairly unregulated before this time, with only a minimum landing size, and then there was a bag limit introduction. However, this was not really science-based, it was more political decision, and the implications of this change in management were pretty unknown. And we wanted to study how these management change would affect the fishery. And first of all, we wanted to identify potential change points in catch and harvest rates of these cod anglers for charter boat anglers and private boat anglers. And then we also wanted to assess if there are any signs of hyperstability in the cod fishery. And last, also investigate travel distances, so how they travel in Germany and how the travel distances might change due to the management. We used data from our multi-annual stratified on-site access point survey. So this runs actually from 2005 already, but we took data from 2009 to 2019, so 11 years. And the data collection, it's a stratified data collection with five strata, and we have access points that are harbors or beaches, and we have the primary sampling units are the fishing days. So on average, there are 26 samplings per month, resulting in on average 318 samplings per year, so this is quite extensive. And we had included in this data set now almost 3,500 samplings and with almost 22,000 interviewed anglers. And the samplers, they collect different data, for example, the fishing site, the angling platform, and very important, the cod released and harvested fish by species, and then several demographics data like age, zip code, etc. And in this study, I focus on sea-based angling methods. So We also monitor shore-based angling, but in this case, I use only data from charter boats and private boats. This is just to show you again where we are. This is Northern Europe, and you see Germany and the Western Baltic Sea. And you see the access points with the black dots bordering the whole German Baltic Sea coast. Method-wise, we used mainly two different statistical analyses. So first, for the change point detection, we took the CPUE and the harvest per unit effort data and standardized them to get rid of some of the variance. And we did this by using boosted regression trees. And then we applied a non-parametric change point analysis to the data. And for the tests of hyperstability, we used a power regression analysis. And then examined the catchability coefficients and the power curve exponents. So getting to some of the results, here you see the development of the boat angler, a private boat angler, catch per unit effort and harvest per unit effort. And it was somehow related to the cod abundance, but we found some change points indicated by the blue vertical lines. But as you can see, I put in the introduction of the back limit with this arrow, they were not directly related to the back limit introduction. For the charter boat anglers, it was a similar picture. The catch rates and the harvest rates were somehow related to cod abundances in the Western Baltic cod stock. And there were also several change points indicating a different values or higher and lower catch per unit effort and harvest per unit effort rates. But again, there was not like a change point directly during the time when the back limit was introduced. And then we tested for hyperstability. And as you can see, there was a weak relationship between catch rates and Western Baltic cod stock size for both boat anglers and charter boat anglers. But we didn't find any signs of hyperstability. So hyperstability means that you would see that the catch rates remain stable even when the cod stock is going down. And this can be quite dangerous for the stock, because fisheries management is not really seeing any effects until the stock is more or less collapsed. So if we look at the travel distances, you can see all the about 8,000 anglers. You see where they were located from on this map, and a bit over 50% of them live in the coastal states that are bordering the Baltic Sea. But there's also a substantial portion that travels from non-coastal states further away, further down in the south. And we have very, very few international anglers, so it's mainly a German fishery. And travel distances ranged from almost 0 kilometers to almost 1,000, which is also the longest distance you can actually travel in Germany. And the median travel distance was 194 kilometers. And we wanted to see if there are any effects of the back limit implementation on the travel distances. And as you can see, there were not really huge effects. The private boat angling remained more or less stable. What we saw in the charter boat fishery, that the guys who are traveling very long distances, so the upper limits, they got lower when the back limit was introduced in 2017. So there was some effect on the travel distances of the charter boat anglers. So to conclude, we saw that the catch and harvest rates varied over time for both charter boat and boat anglers and were somehod related to cod abundances. And we also detected several change points, but they were not directly related to the introduction of the back limit. The power regression found no statistical evidence of the presence of hyperstability, but we need to keep in mind that the time series with 11 years was relatively short and also lacking contrast because we had not really a time where the cod stock was very, very high, like in the 1980s, for example. And also the spatio-temporal resolution of the spawning stock biomass data from the assessment was poor because it's just one huge management area and we have no data on a more smaller spatial resolution. And what also could be that the back limit and the stock collapse were of course somehow related because the back limit was introduced because the stock was so low. And it may be that this has influenced the relationship between SSB and catch rates. Regarding the travel distances, as you saw, the majority of the German Western Baltic cod anglers came from these coastal states, but more than 60% travels more than 100 kilometers, so there's quite an inland tourism. The travel distances of the charter boat anglers decreased a bit after the back limit introduction, but no effects were found on the boat anglers. And this might be explained by that boat anglers may be a bit more flexible, also maybe less catch orientated, because flexible in terms of that they can switch between target species. Compared to charter boat anglers who are very focusing on cod angling. But this is something we need to further investigate. And the overall conclusion is that it's important to have these long-term monitoring programs and data collections to identify changes and change point and to improve management in the future. So, that's it. Thank you very much. And if you are interested in more results, you can check out these two papers where the data has been published already. So thank you very much.
Okay, we've got a few minutes. We will have Q&A session at the end, but I thought I'd open up the opportunity for one question now, given we got a few spare minutes. Yep.
So I just wanted to ask if the sampling methodology is consistent between Germany and neighboring states.
Not really. We have actually like a regional coordination, and we all collect data and they all go into the assessment, but the ways the countries collect data are pretty different in a way. So, but it also depends because the fisheries are somehow a bit different between countries. So it's, we are always discussing if this there's a way to really make a common survey method, but in the end it's difficult. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, please join me in thanking Simon one last time. Okay, up next we have Robbie Porter from Ausfisch, and I can see there's a heap of Ausfisch people in the room. Robbie's talk is named Fisher Science and Its Role in Habitat Restoration. I'll just get that up for you.
So sorry to disappoint you folks, but I'm not Robbie. I'm Steve. I'm a volunteer on the project with Robbie. And I've been asked to just talk briefly about my experience as a volunteer. Not much experience as a public speaker, obviously. So I'm retired like a lot of our volunteers. And like a lot of you people, I love fishing. I've always loved fishing. I like everything about fishing, like most of you. I fell in love with fishing when I was about this high, and my dad gave me a hold of his line. So it was an old cork thing with, cord, a little thin cord, and a little whiting took the bait. And I ran up the beach and pulled in this little whiting about that big. I've been hooked ever since. And then as I grew up, I sort of went fishing a lot more. We did all sorts of boat fishing, land fishing, camping with mates. and like most people my age, we love fishing, but we really didn't give a damn about fish or the environment. So, you know, everything we caught, we either killed or kept. All our rubbish just went overboard. You know, we chucked everything away, bait bags, the whole lot went into the water, or we left it by the beach. You know, terrible. We didn't know any better, but really I was an environmental vandal. Okay, keep going. Anyway, as I grew older, times changed, attitudes changed, and I'd like to think that I changed with the times and became more aware of what we need to do. And that, you know, we've got a wonderful opportunity here to look after what we've got. If you've been to some developing countries, you'll know, you know, what can happen if you don't. When I was getting ready for retirement, people used to ask me all the time, what are you going to do when you retire? Oh, that's better. You know, what's your plan when you retire? What are you going to do? Well, I was always going to fish. That was a no-brainer. And I wanted to do some volunteer work, but I didn't know what. And then one night I was I was just reading a local fishing forum, and I saw a post from this fella about shellfish restoration. I thought, that sounds interesting. So I contacted Robbie and said, can we go for a fish and talk about what, you know, whether I can help or not. And then I don't know whether it was guilt that made me join up, you know, for my past sins, or whether it was just being with people that have the same attitude as me towards the water and fish and life. So whatever it was, I joined up, and it was one of the best decisions of my life. I worked with some fantastic people on this project. We've had hundreds of people have come through over the years, and everyone's made a difference. But we've got a core group of people who are, who are the quiet achievers. You know, these guys actually put in ridiculous hours. They do stuff that they never tell anybody about. They're a great team. There are no egos, like egos are parked at the gate. People just muck in, get stuff done. You know, if I had found a team like this when I was working, I'd probably still be working. So, you know, I'm not an evangelistic sort of environmentalist. I don't hang from the story bridge with a banner. I don't glue myself to the road. I'm just an old fisherman who wants to help out. And, you know, this has been a perfect outlet for me to do that. People ask me, why did you join Ausfish? And, you know, I could bang on about what a great national organisation it is, how I love to be part of something bigger, and that's true. But really, it's about who I work with and what a great team it is. It's really just about the opportunity to give back a little bit and to work with some absolute legends. So that's my story, badly told. So I hand over to one of those legends, Robbie.
Thank you. Thanks, Steve, and not very badly told at all. To hear why volunteers do it and the passion that they have for actually making fish habitat a better place is inspiring for me and why I'm here too. Hopefully this video works. This is Turkey Beach, and just while that plays, I just wanted to thank the Kwandamuka people, who's where we do most of our efforts in Moreton Bay. It's really important to talk to them, and we've been lucky to open some communication channels with them. They've sustainably managed shellfish in that area for a very long time, and it's not sustainable now. It's basically all gone. This is some images we did with a PhD candidate who's doing her work on tropical shellfish reefs and the species and things that live on them. This is up at Turkey Beach, which is just north of Bundaberg, and honestly, it's sort of become my mecca. It's like an amazing place to see. And these ones are a leaf oyster as well, which are very understudied, isomobid, and there's a huge patch of them there. We felt very privileged to do it. It's really been inspiring to me to do a lot of things, and what the talk's about is to do fisher science. So just briefly about shellfish reefs, we lost them because mostly, well, we ate some of them, but mostly because they make fantastic mortar. And so the shells were collected, and you saw that images before where they're nice little lumps. They could pick them up, chuck them in a sugar bag, take them to a kiln, burn them, and mix them with sand and water, and you've got the perfect cement. And most of Brisbane, because I talk specifically about Moreton Bay, was built with sandstone blocks and the mortar made from the shells in Moreton Bay. They were hampered greatly. You know, we're doing a lot of roads, a lot of farming, and we had big floods in 1893, and so a lot of the substrate, the shells that were left, oysters love to grow on oysters, were covered in mud and not coming back. And today, that substrate's got a lot of competition with high nutrients and the algae that grow from those nutrients. So yeah, they're very much substrate limited. So we needed to work out a way to do it. And we're told that shell is a great substrate. Oysters find it, there's a chemical signature in the shell and oysters want to grow on it. So we wanted to build some thing to make fish food, put these structures back. So having a shellfish reef, fish making machines, we came up with an invention which is basically just a gabion basket filled with shell. It's designed to rot away as the oysters grow on it. But oysters really are what considered the livers of our ocean, and they filter the water as well. And taking things like microplastics at a certain size out of the system is really important. Water clarity is great for recreational fishes and boaties, but also things like seagrasses and other environments, that other habitats that require light penetration through the water to photosynthesize. So yeah, in about 30 minutes, this tank. And you can see a few different species in that tank. There's the oysters, the rock oysters, but there's also like a pink tarter, like a pearl oyster as well. So these are what our reefs look like after, that one's about 2 years old, a bit over 2 years old, compared to other reefs. They get encrusted and you can see some of the degradation, all the steel starting to degrade, and they become like a self-sustaining shellfish reefs. But it's important to us to be able to sell this to the world. Like Craig in his talk the other day was saying how it's hard to get legislation to get these things back. You can bang on all day about how, you know, they filter water and how they make fish and how the biodiversity is there, but you actually have to prove it. And so we're in a unique position. We've got so many fantastic Ausfish volunteers, but it doesn't matter if we go and say, yeah, I saw a really good reef the other day and they're doing really great. We've actually had to prove it. So we want to prove that these are actually doing what we hope and claim that they will do. We do that through Fisher Science. We're working with three universities in Queensland, Griffith University, University of Queensland, and the University of Sunshine Coast. And we're having meetings on Friday to talk about master students and PhD and doctorates coming through to do their work with us and on our units. So it's really quite exciting. And we've had a lot of help support from Griffith University, and next week, Monday, Tuesday and Wednesday, they'll actually be doing destructive surveys on our reefs, and they'll count, you know, how many oysters are on there, and then the mobile vertebrates that are on there as well, which are really the fish foods. So they've helped us a great deal setting up our reporting, getting our data right and actually having it so that it can be read and manage it, and then we can report it so we can put it out there. I think that's an incredibly important thing to lean on the scientists for, is to get that help, because if you just write down a few notes and you don't know what you're doing, like I don't, you know, that's not really a great way. I mean, we've seen so many scientists come up and show fantastic data sets that it's really great to be able to lean on those scientists to get that. So some of the techniques we're using, we like fish, so remote underwater video is really great. Sometimes we add bait and make it a brov, not a rov. And that's been terrific. And Muttley over here is, where's Muttley? Sorry, there. He's our manager. He's a volunteer that manages all our video and does the cameras and everything like that. And it's fantastic, the work that he does. I really recognise that. And he's been able to get influence from scientists to show that how that works and actually get all the reporting sorted out. Another way we do is destructive surveys. We did one the other week on one of our intertidal oyster baskets and ripped it apart. And then we had Marina Richardson come and help us work out what to do and how to do it. And we had a lot of students from Griffith University as well, and University of Queensland, and University of Sunshine Coast come and actually help identify all those mobile invertebrates, which is really tricky and hard to do because they look weird, and I'll show you a few images in a minute. It's a heap, so I don't know what they are. And of course we do transects and quadrants just to show what's there and whether there's change. And what we found is that there is lots of food. So it was fun. A lot of crabs live in these structures. Within 3 months in the subtidal zone, we found the crabs and prawns. All these first images are from subtidal, file clams and heaps of bivalves, but so many crabs. There's a cute little one there hiding in these snapping shrimps. So they were really great to see that. And this lot's from the intertidal zone, and they're quite different. We get a lot more snails. Still a lot of worms, polychaete and tube worms. Less tube worms in the intertidal, more in the subtidal. And that thing, if anyone can let me know what that is, that'd be really cool. It's great to be able to have that science base behind it, get actually people to design the way it's done, to actually give us lists, to say, put this, take a photo of this, put it on this spreadsheet, write about it this side, weigh it, size class it. And we've found that there are a lot more fish. So the fish food's working. They're attracted to these and they come pretty much straight away. We believe they're working. But again, we need more data and more science and more independence, I guess, is important as well, is to not have Joe Blow, who's got a lot of vested interest in it working, to be able to report it. Which is really cool. So then into reporting. So this is what we found. This is simply a very early survey on one of our baskets. It was about 2,240 reef building shellfish. That's oysters, that's hairy mussels, and pearl oyster, pinctadas, as well as a spiny oyster as well. So they're our main reef forming engineering ones. But the fish food are the mobile invertebrates, and there was about 1,000 on that first one. So we'll get a bigger data set in the next week. So what's it mean? We've put 3,800 reefs in the water so far, and that's over a 2-year period. Thank you. And, it's a simple process. We're in a subtidal area there. We just throw them in. And if you expand that out, we've, got homes for another over 7 million of those reef-forming shellfish and nearly 4 million fish foods, or the mobile invertebrates, which is really cool. This is something that we'll be continuing doing for a long time. We want to expand into other areas in Moreton Bay, areas where historically they were, and we want it to be like here, like it was at Turkey Beach. So yeah, they make lots of food, and I think they're very pretty as well. So thank you very much.
All right, thanks guys, thanks Robbie. We do have a minute or two before the next talk, so if anyone wanted to ask a quick question now, otherwise we'll defer until the Q&A at the end. For now. Okay, continuing with our theme of resource monitoring, our next speaker is Dr. Crystal Beckmann. Crystal's from the South Australian Research Development Institution, or as we call it, SARDI. If I could just ask you all to give Crystal a warm welcome.
Thanks for joining for the talk today. So yeah, I'm from South Australia and we've recently done a recreational fishing survey. And I'm just going to give a bit of an overview of the results of that. It actually just got put on the website this morning. So after the talk, you're welcome to go and have a look and look at some of the results in more detail. So we worked with the University of Tasmania really closely on this project. So we'll go through some of the results. So South Australia, obviously we've heard a lot about the important economic, cultural and social value of fishing. This holds true for South Australians. It's really important. And a lot of our recreational fishing is undertaken in our marine waters, including estuaries, with a smaller amount of freshwater effort. South Australia's community-owned fishery resources support an important shared access fishery, with specified shares allocated to each sector. So the information to assess these allocations generally comes from commercial fishery logbooks, and we don't have a recreational fishing licence system, so generally our recreational catches come from surveys, and the exception is for the snapper fishery in the southeast, which is currently managed under mandatory reporting. So standardised survey methods were developed for estimating participation, catch and effort, and they were implemented during the national survey, which was conducted in 2000-2001. And since then, there's been a few other surveys, so we will be presenting the fourth comprehensive assessment of recreational fishing in South Australia. So I won't go into too much detail about the methods, but it was a multi-phase survey using a sampling frame regionally stratified. So that's a random sample of South Australian residents drawn from a database. We conducted screening to collect information on profiling, fishing participation and avidity. We did a longitudinal phase, so that was the diary phase where we collected information on fishing activity, which ran from February 2021 to March 2022. We then conducted some non-intending fisher callbacks to account for unexpected fishing activity to make adjustments to our participation rates. And we did a wash-up survey at the conclusion to look at motivations, awarenesses and attitudes from recreational fishers. Our catch information was reported by fishers in terms of number. So we also conducted on-site sampling, which is an opportunistic program designed to target key sites at busy times to get information on mean size data to then convert those numbers through to weights so they're comparable with our commercial harvest estimates. So moving in straight into the results, based on the recalled activity from the 12 months prior to the survey, 357,000 South Australian residents aged 5 years or older fished at least once in South Australia, representing an overall participation rate of around 23%. For those of you who went to the presentation on the national survey results, I believe that was around 360,000 recreational fishers. Just keeping in mind, I guess, that that was a different period for when that estimate was produced, and they also used slightly different methods. But realistically, it's a very similar number of people estimated by the two methods. The population has just increased through time, which affects the participation rate. Fisher numbers were higher in 2021, so back to our survey now. They were higher in 2021 than in the previous three surveys, but lower than the... and this coincided with an increase in participation, increase in South Australian population over the past 20 years. Participation rates were higher in regional areas, so the red dashed line represents the statewide average. And this really highlights the importance of recreational fishing to regional communities. While there's been high population growth in Adelaide since 2001, regions have experienced limited population growth, so really just showing that the participation is related to people's real love of fishing in those areas. In terms of some of the demographic trends, fishing continues to be most popular amongst males in South Australia. Male participation rates in 2021 were higher than the previous two surveys. In the previous three surveys, and this was likely due to the retention of this large cohort of 30 to 44-year-old fishers, which were prominent during the first survey that was undertaken. And obviously there's a range of different constraints and values that will influence those trends. In terms of female participation, quite an interesting result. We saw higher participation rates for females than the previous three surveys across most of the age groups. So yeah, really interesting when you consider some of the constraints relevant to females fishing. But I think the take home in terms of participation is that participation rates still did tend to be highest amongst children, so amongst that 5 to 14 year old age group for both genders, which indicates an underlying decline in retention rather than recruitment of persons to the pastime. So in terms of effort, during our survey period, recreational fishers undertook 1.3 million fisher days of effort, fishing on average about 4 days per year. None of this has changed very much from the previous surveys. Basically, line fishing was the most common method, followed by crab nets and cray pots. And we saw that fishing in marine waters accounted for most of the fishing effort, and shore-based fishing accounted for greater effort than boat-based fishing. So despite the large number of fishers and high participation rates during the survey, effort was a little bit lower compared to the survey done in 2000-2001. So boat-based effort has been relatively similar between all of our surveys, but you can see some of the trends in marine and shore-based effort are quite similar. And so although we've had an increase compared to the previous two surveys, it's still quite low compared to the one done 20 years ago. So that's probably due to some issues around accessibility and people's experience in relation to those different platforms. So just to give a really brief overview of catch, because there's 90 or more species that we had reported on during the survey, but just at the high level, in terms of finfish, we had nearly 5 million finfish caught, so that's retained and released fish. There was a wide variety of species, with King George whiting being the most commonly caught, followed by Australian herring, southern garfish and Australian salmon. We had a further 6 million invertebrates, with blue swimmer crab. That was our most common species caught in the whole survey, followed by pipi, yabby and calamari. So we broke it down into marine and freshwater, and so just to give you a bit of an idea of the types of species that ranked quite highly. So your King George whiting, blue swimmer crabs and pipi in the marine space, and then your yabbies and shrimp obviously being small and highly numerous in the freshwater space. In terms of boat-based fishing, King George whiting and blue swimmer crab are our bread and butter species, obviously, in our boat-based sector. But interestingly, we also have a large shore-based component for blue swimmer crabs, so quite important to look at that at the regional scale to try to start to untangle some of those trends. Targeted species, mostly our King George whiting and crabs again, and things that need more specialised gear, so like rock lobster, also ranked highly. Non-target, we're mostly looking at Australian herring, Western Australian salmon as our main non-target species, as well as some things like carp, which are incidentally captured. In terms of release weights, most of our sort of key species had release rates of between 30 and 60%. We had lower release rates, particularly for things like garfish and southern calamari. And then for some of our species which are either captured for catch and release or have rules and regulations in place, we had higher release rates, so things like snapper, which is currently only able to be taken outside of the southeast, Murray cod, and also some of our like reef species and sharks and rays, which are often reported as having undesirable eating qualities. Within the report, we present fairly detailed species snapshots for around 20 different species. So just to give a little example of one today, we had King George whiting. So we had 1.8 million King George whiting caught, including retained and released fish, with most of those coming out of our Gulf. So Gulf St. Vincent is our Gulf, which is adjacent to our Metropolitan Centre, and then Spencer Gulf. And we also have a large amount coming out of our West Coast, which is actually a really important tourist area as well. So about 38% of the catch for King George whiting was released, and it was mostly taken from boats, with line fishing being the predominant method, mostly using bait. Catch was concentrated in inshore coastal waters, with the remainder taken from offshore waters. And in terms of the temporal trends, we had enough data to have a look at that, and so we had a peak in catch in March, April, and then a secondary peak in September, October. So then sort of the next interesting part is around the trends in catch composition. So comparing the number of fish caught or invertebrates caught through time just at the statewide level for the purposes of this presentation. So species like species like blue swimmer crab have been relatively similar in terms of catch through time looking at our survey estimates. But then when we start to look at things like King George whiting and Australian herring, while we had similar estimates for the last three surveys, the catch was lower than what was observed in 2000-2001. So obviously things like fish availability is likely to be a factor, as there have been some declines in recruitment for species like King George whiting. And then Australian herring is probably another interesting one. It's not frequently targeted, and it's also likely to be highly dependent on larval transport to nursery areas in South Australia, so highly influenced by variable recruitment. Snapper and garfish were two species where we saw notable declines in catch in this survey. And so the low catch of snapper is not unexpected given that it's only able to be taken in the southeast at the moment. So that reflects the high release rates for snapper during the survey period. Garfish, there's been a number of management measures in place to promote the recovery of garfish. So again, not surprising that the catch would be quite low compared to previous times where the bag limits and boat limits were higher. So onto some of the sort of key findings and implications from the survey. So social values are really highlighted as a key driver. So spending time with family and friends has really increased in importance over the past two decades, as indicated by our wash-up survey. We had some real demographic shifts, so namely the ageing population in South Australia, increase in female participation, which highlights some of the changes in leisure constraints through time. There were differences in catch, particularly at the regional scale, and these are likely due to differences in effort and changes in fishing practices and species availability. So there were some really complex trends in catch and effort. So this may be due to changes... this really identifies that we need to have a look at the spatial patterns and that changes may be related to availability and access. And it just really highlights the need for precise information to be collected on recreational fishing at the appropriate spatial scales to inform fishery management. So this brings us to some of the key challenges. Obviously, there are challenges around surveys in terms of sampling frames. And so there's going to be some ongoing issues around the precision of the estimates unless we look at different ways to do these surveys. And the precision is really influenced by sample size and by variability in the population. So as we don't have a list of recreational fishers, there's going to be an ongoing need to use these probability-based methods. But we can look to start to investigate things like app-based methods to develop non-probability estimates. And that's something that we're currently investigating actually as part of this study to try and reduce the lag in between the large-scale surveys and get some kind of proxy for catch and effort between those. So just give a really quick overview of where we're at with our app-based trial, given that there's been much discussion during this conference about these app-based methods. So during our survey period, we also trialled a voluntary app. So if you weren't selected to participate in the longitudinal diary phase of the phone diary survey, any recreational fishers in South Australia were able to download our fishing guide app and participate in our app-based trial. So during the survey, we had around 2,500 surveys completed. And we had around 2,000 participants. So on average, it was kind of around 200 active users per month. So during this period, we collected information on demographics, so including fishing avidity, where people lived. So fishing avidity is how often they fished in the last 12 months, their age, their gender, their education, a whole range of factors. And these were the same things that we collected during our screening survey of our population. So then we were able to go and have a look and see which types of factors may be under or overrepresented in our different samples. So then we could start along that process of developing weighting factors and try to do an expansion to go from our sample up to, you know, the population level to see whether we could use these app-based data to inform our stock assessments. So I guess the big question is, can app-based data be incorporated into stock assessments as a tool to inform decision-making? So we've started along that process. We're investigating different weighting methods. This is just an example for King George whiting that we've been working on. So just doing some basic raking and response propensity modelling. We've applied adjustments based on responses to our wash-up survey around non-response. And then we've applied weightings based on those demographic factors. So if you have a bit of a look at the screening one, so this takes into account fishing avidity, whereas the census does not. You can see that we are at the moment getting similar estimates of effort for King George Whiting compared to our probability-based survey using our app. And so our next step is to obviously investigate a range of procedures and a range of different species. And have a look and see whether this could take us in the direction of being able to estimate these things for catch as well. Just to wrap up, I'd like to acknowledge our funding bodies and our research partners and all of the recreational fishers who participated in these surveys, because without them it wouldn't be possible to present these types of data. Thanks very much.
Thanks very much, Crystal. It's a massive project. I'm sure there's a lot to dissect once the results come in from these types of surveys. Thanks, Trav. Okay, we're right on time, actually. So moving on to our fourth speaker for today, we have Kenneth Brennan. Kenneth hails from the US and he's a lead fish biologist at NOAA Fisheries Service. Kenneth's title, just get this up. Okay. Can I ask you all to please welcome Kenneth?
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Ken Brennan. I'm with NOAA Fisheries, Southeast Fisheries Science Center. There I manage recreational data collection programs that cover the Atlantic and Gulf of Mexico and Caribbean. My presentation today will be covering advances in data collection using electronic technologies in for-hire fisheries in the southeastern United States. I'd like to start by stating our goals for using electronic reporting. And when I refer to electronic reporting in this context, I'm specifically referring to logbook or trip level reporting, which is collecting catch and effort and socioeconomic data. One of the primary goals of electronic reporting is to increase the accuracy of the data. And one way of doing that is to reduce the recall bias due to the quick turnaround that electronic reporting affords. We also strive to collect near real-time data and make that data available as soon as possible. Another goal is to get a near census of the universe of vessels we're surveying. And with electronic reporting, this is more achievable. And another key goal is to for in-season data for fishery quota monitoring. This is very important in the Southeast U.S. When I refer to for-hire fisheries in the United States, it includes two components, the charter boat and the headboat, which are also referred to as party boats. Charter boats are inspected to carry 6 passengers generally. They primarily troll for pelagic fish such as billfish, tuna, wahoo, and mahi. The headboat are multi-passenger vessels which are inspected to carry up to 150 passengers. These vessels fish a variety of ways, but primarily bottom fish for reef fish such as snapper, grouper, grunts, and many other demersal species. For-hire vessels in the United States, Southeast United States, are separated by two management regions, the South Atlantic and Gulf of Mexico. In the South Atlantic, which runs from the North Carolina border to Florida, there are currently just over 1,700 vessels that are federally permitted to fish in federal waters. These vessels run an estimated 280,000 trips per year. In the Gulf of Mexico, from Florida to Texas, there are just over 1,000 vessels that make an estimated 128,000 trips per year. So as you can see, that's a tremendous amount of fishing effort. It does have significant economic benefits, but it also has significant impacts on fish populations. I'd like to briefly review the regulatory history of electronic reporting to give you a sense of how long it takes to set the stage in order to implement electronic technologies in this fishery. The U.S. manages its fisheries through fishery management councils, which are represented by these different regions throughout the U.S. I think we've heard that in other presentations. It's a very important part of our management strategy in the U.S. And in the case of electronic reporting in the Southeast, I'm referring to the South Atlantic and Gulf of Mexico Fishery Management Council. This timeline shows just how long it took to make electronic reporting mandatory on for-hire vessels. Would like to point out that in 2013, we already had headboats reporting on logbook forms as far back as 1972. So in 2013, we transitioned from paper logs to electronic logbooks, and that's 10 years ago, and this worked well. We've been able to make significant improvements to our program because of it. But charter boats weren't required to report electronically or even on a logbook until this 2016 amendment development started by both councils. So it took a couple of years to get these amendments approved by both councils. And by 2021, when the infrastructure was put in place, we were able to begin trip-level electronic reporting in the South Atlantic and the Gulf of Mexico. And also another milestone in 2022, just last year, in the Gulf of Mexico, where vessel monitoring systems are required, we implemented that on all charter boats and headboats. So the different regulations among regions, another thing I'd like to point out, these fisheries management councils have different expectations and demands for electronic reporting. And these differences between the South Atlantic and Gulf of Mexico are evident here. These regulations also determine the extent of the technologies that are needed in the regions. As you can see, the Gulf of Mexico is much stricter in their regulations. The captain has to declare a trip before he leaves the dock. Also, the captain has to land the fish at an approved landing location, submit a trip before they offload any fish or passengers. And as I mentioned, the VMS is required, and that has to be permanently affixed to the vessel and operational 24/7 with hourly positioning. The South Atlantic, less strict, trip level reporting on a weekly basis, and then weekly no fishing reports for periods of inactivity. And there are just about 300 vessels that are duly permitted in the Southeast. Those vessels are required to report to the stricter regulations, which is the Gulf of Mexico requirements. Although there are different regulations for the regions, the two approved electronic reporting platforms and software are the same for each region. NOAA has to approve this these software and hardware applications, and these are currently these are the two applications that are approved. ETRIPS, which is managed by Atlantic States Cooperative Statistics Program, and Vessel, which is managed by Bluefin Data. Both of these have similar capacities, and they are free. So it's up to the captain which one of these they choose to use. Here's a look at the web portal reporting application for Vessel. You can see that the on the dashboard there that the captain can choose to check their reporting status, create a new trip, or create a no fishing report. And then also they can find a trip, a previous trip that they've entered, This is a nice bonus for the captain for counting purposes, or if they want to go back and see what they were catching in any particular time of the year, they have their whole catch history available to them. This is the web portal for eTrips, different style, the black background that the strategy there was to reduce glare and make it more readable in bright sunlight. So it's just a style thing, but both of these are collecting the same data, and it's just a captain's preference which one they use. And another application that's available for reporting is the mobile app. This is a cellular reporting. Both the South Atlantic and the Gulf of Mexico are the same as far as their use of these applications. So the mobile app is compatible with iPhones and Androids. It is reliant on cell service, so if the captain is out of cell range, they can still submit the trip. It'll just hold until they get within cell signal, and then it will send. The average cost of the unit and monthly service fees is less. Captains do a tremendous amount of business on their phones, so they already have data plans, and this is not a significant cost increase to them. They're already proficient with their phones. And we've found it about 80 to 85% of the captains prefer the mobile app. So this is very convenient for them to use, and we've gotten positive feedback on that. The VMS satellite reporting and tracking units in the Gulf of Mexico, they transmit location data real time, and they do have reporting capabilities outside of cellular range, obviously, and they provide additional features such as weather, ship to shore, and a lot of other bells and whistles that the captain can choose from as far as their units. They're reliable. They have a low failure rate, less than 1%. So these units are pretty solid. And however, they do have increased subscription fees and costs. So that's something the captain has to consider. So finally, since these advancements in data collection have been implemented, we've realized these benefits. There's been increased participation through monitoring, reporting, compliance. We hold the captains accountable to report these trips, so that's increased participation, which has also in turn improved landings and effort estimates. It's streamlined reporting. It's less burden on a captain than paper, and it takes about 8 to 10 minutes to submit a trip, depending on the size of the catch or complexity of the catch, but generally 8 to 10 minutes. And on our end, it's an increased efficiency in data processing. We're able to turn the data around much more quickly and get it to end users or for management purposes or science purposes. So it's really streamline things on the data management side. So timeliness of data, we're able to provide in-season data for monitoring fishing quotas, which in turn lessens the chance of overages of quota and payback on the next fishing year. So this is an additional benefit for electronic reporting. And then finally, the angler provided data builds more confidence in using the data. The constituents are part of the process providing that data, and they're more confident in the results of stock assessments and management decisions if they know they're part of the process. So with that, thank you for your time.
Thanks very much, Kenneth. I've probably got time for one quick question if anyone has one. Otherwise, we'll defer to the end.
Hi everyone, thank you for having me here. My name's Amy, I'm from New Zealand. I work for Wellington Fish and Game Council, and I'm really nervous. I'm here today to discuss part of my thesis, and that thesis is the part that does address assessing and mitigating population level vulnerability of Indigenous New Zealand fish to trout predation. I was actually looking overall at the interactions between trout and native fish, but this is the bit that I found most interesting and became the bulk of my thesis. Although actually, if I'm to be honest, I'm probably here to learn more from you all and to eat some of that yummy food, so I have enjoyed that. Okay. Firstly though, a really high level introduction to New Zealand's flora and fauna. So the continent of Zealandia, the islands of New Zealand, just the little bits that stick up above the water, separated from Gondwana land approximately 80 million years ago. So everything has had a really long time to evolve in some splendid isolation. Many of these species that are found only in New Zealand, in terrestrial fauna, for example, with birds and vertebrates and three species of bats, or it used to be three species of bat, often have long lifespans, they grow quite large, and they mature to breeding age slowly. Our native fish species are similarly ancient and unique, although they do share some species such as Inanga with Australia and South America. Many of our freshwater fish species are small, cryptic and benthic. They often preferentially inhabit interstitial subsea spaces and some up to 2 metres deep. Most are also nocturnal, so they're quite hard to spot. The most widespread species are diadromous, moving between marine and freshwater during their life cycles. By contrast, we also have plenty native non-diadromous species that tend to be located further inland and are much more range-restricted. Many of our species are morphologically very similar. Recent advances in DNA sequencing have indicated that where fish were assumed to be just one species, they're actually, in fact, often multiple species. One of the best-known examples of this is the Canterbury galaxid. It was once thought to be one widespread species, but now the DNA sequencing shows probably up to at least 12 different species. So this kind of new development in technology is actually quite important when we go and look back at old literature or older literature, and sometimes some of these behavioural differences that were noted in experiments or in the field are actually quite species dependent. We didn't know at that time. More than 70% of our native fish species are threatened, primarily due to habitat degradation. In spite of this, they're not protected legally, apart from one species, which is the New Zealand grayling, who went extinct around about 1920. However, in fact, they're fished, both commercially and recreationally, particularly eels, both the shortfin and longfin eels, and the white bait, which is actually the juvenile stage of five of our diadromous galaxid species, and smelt, although I don't think anybody actually really likes smelt. Another very brief overview, human colonisation of New Zealand. When the Māori people arrived in Aotearoa, they brought with them plants, kuri, the dog, and kiore, the Polynesian rats. He's had some terrestrial impacts, but no real aquatic ones. Māori prized the fish resource they found in relocating and stocking some of the lakes and native species, and they consider all freshwater fauna to be taonga, which is treasure. Europeans arrived much later and brought with them everything else. We also brought sports fish. Trout, which is where I started to come in, were introduced for food, for recreational fishing, and to combat homesickness. Trout are now widespread throughout New Zealand and important for recreational, cultural, and economic reasons. They also provide benefits for physical, mental, and emotional well-being. Trout do have legal protections. Their habitat requirements are well known, and their need for cool, clear water makes them a useful environmental umbrella species. Fishing game. So the fishing game councils were established in 1991 from the old acclimatisation societies. We are the statutory authority of sports fish and game birds in New Zealand, and we have a mandate to manage, maintain, and enhance trout fisheries and habitats for our anglers. We are funded solely by licence sales. We're the leading agency for freshwater protections in New Zealand based on what our licence holders, our recreational anglers, and our hunters ask from us. For example, 15 water conservation orders in New Zealand, which is sort of like a smallish scale, like a national park for a waterway. Of that 15, 13 of them were won and fought for and paid for by Fish and Game. We have a strong focus on improving freshwater and wetland habitat, and we use the protection of trout and trout spawning habitat, which is enshrined in the legislation at present, to minimise harm to water bodies from human activity, development, dams, in-stream works, and flood protection streams, and fish passage barriers. So my thesis came about really looking very carefully and closely at, on the one hand, we have this highly valued introduced species which provides a host of benefits. But they are an introduced species, and they're also an active predator of some of our small, cryptic, benthic, endangered native species. There's this increasing narrative that predation by trout is a major driver of the declines of abundance and the distribution of native species. That said, often in the same body of work, it's frequently noted that not all species are impacted equally, and in fact, these impacts do vary on location as well. So I spent too much time, reading through a lot of literature, some amazing works, and determined that predation is the behaviour most likely to detrimentally impact species at a population level. I did look at competition. I did look, obviously, at biological interactions between parasites or disease vectors as well. They didn't have the impact the predation does. So the introduction of mammals and birds has led to the extinction of roughly half of New Zealand's native bird species, which is horrendous. So we were rightfully, although belatedly, concerned about the introduced species dynamics with our native species of what we have left. It is important to note, however, when we're talking about an aquatic ecology, the sole freshwater fish species extinction of the New Zealand grayling is completely unrelated to fish introduction. So we're looking at quite different dynamics. It's very difficult. People tend to like to look at it through an terrestrial lens, but it's important to look at the actual ecology of the water system itself. So the literature review were then focused on species biology, ecology, and behaviours to create a risk assessment matrix in order to determine the species most likely to be vulnerable to impacts of trout predation. I did only look and focus on those interactions in flowing water systems and rivers and streams. I didn't look at lakes. It would have taken me another 17 years. Now, please also note, the risk of this and the whole focus of this is the impact of predation at a population level. How likely is it for trout predation to make a species become extinct or extirpated at a local level? Because obviously being eaten is terribly detrimental to the prey individual itself, but I was looking at that higher level impact overall. So how we did this is come up with a bunch of risk factors which increased or decreased that risk of predation and population level impacts. So these included the adult size, so we're looking at a size limitation here. Some species outgrow the ability to be predated by any size trout. We're looking at pouched lamprey or our eel species. Or you're looking at smaller bodied galaxids which never outgrow that size limit. Look at the threat ranking by the IUCN Red List. How threatened are they overall? Obviously, if you've got a highly endangered species, any predation is going to be problematic to that population. We looked at age, when reducing sexual maturity, we've got a fecundity and egg size, and the likelihood overall of a species to be in the same place at the same time as a hungry trout. Some factors appear to increase vulnerability more than others, so these were weighted. You see this here with the weighting system, and some were not. I've shown two examples here. I won't go into any the differences between them because we just don't have that sort of time, but they come right at the most highly vulnerable here with the dusky galaxid, which is a non-diadromous, small, threatened with a slow life strategies, versus a black flounder, which is much larger, diadromous, and just seems to be hanging out in quite different spaces at different times, although they eat the same food. And then once I had those, and I won't go into this in too much detail either, but this is what we came out with, and I grouped them into risk levels of highly vulnerable, at a moderate vulnerable, and a minor levels of vulnerability. And overall, we do tend to see that the most vulnerable species are the non-diadromous, range-restricted, slow to reach sexual maturity, with low fecundity and larval dispersal. So it sort of makes sense, really. I mean, these are the populations, these are the species that are not likely to bounce back from any interference, and these are the ones that we would generally want to make sure we were going to try and keep them safe. And from there, we pushed all these data and put all the numbers into it, and we took the fish location data from the New Zealand Freshwater Fish Database to create this sort of map, which is really horrible, but I'm just learning. So we're getting there. And these maps show the overlapping distributions with trout, where there's no colour, where it's just blue, there isn't trout. But where those colours, the green is with the lowest levels of you know, minor vulnerability levels, right through to the red, which is the highest and most vulnerable populations where they overlap with trout. I could not differentiate between the size of trout. Trout size is important in some of these places, so this is just overall any trout. So we're looking at a 10%, approximately 10% overlap with the most vulnerable species in trout across New Zealand. And these areas are also clustered rather than spatially dispersed, which also gives us, I think, easier options for being able to prioritise and triage these areas in terms of restorations and protections for the species. So just another example for when we try and drill down further. My goal is to come up with these sorts of maps so that we can go, hey, people who are working in these areas who are vitally concerned, from iwi groups to council groups to river managers, to us, here's our target, here's our focus. We'll work on these, we'll restore these, and then we can spread out as we go through. Once I'd finished coming up with these maps, it took a little while, I looked into how could we mitigate it. It's not enough to just go, okay, here's a potential map, here's where the problems are. But what do we do when we find them? What do we do about it? And a lot of the literature, all of the literature, was very clearly coming out. Even those literatures that say trout is the main problem, saying habitat, it's the environment, it's the habitat. This is why we can have species in some places and not in others. It depends on how degraded is that environment. Where's the ability for the fish to have their own refuges from any kind of predation? So there's a little table here. There's much more in the thesis, but just for brevity, well, if we're looking at having rivers with natural form and flow and function, if we're looking at having woody debris, if we're looking at having microhabitats that support a range of life, we're looking at minimising nutrients and pollutants in the sediment infill. When you think about the fact that a lot of our native species can be 2 metres down, if we flood that area with sediment, they've got nowhere to go. It's not just trout that are going to be a problem, it's kingfisher, it's everything. So these are the lists of some of the actions that we could and should be taking to increase the abundance of our freshwater species and allow for coexistence with trout where possible. Back again, a little step back, the engagement with license holders. So fish and game exists because of and for our recreational anglers, our license holders, and our engagement with them has shown very, very clearly how concerned they are for the health of freshwater and for the health of their fish. and they want to see healthy and abundant freshwater fauna. They're not out there to see more, and we know this, we've heard this over and over again, we're not out there to see more fish all the time, you know, big trout everywhere. They want the experience, they want the health, they want those benefits, they want to see the whole thing working beautifully. And so hopefully this work can start to provide us with an opportunity to, like, and as a manager for it and for fisheries manager and river manager, to start to front foot these discussions instead of waiting for people to come to us and say, hey, your introduced species are killing the native fish. How about we take these? The conclusion. The current narrative is painting trout as a primary driver for loss. However, all biological interactions are completely secondary to environmental conditions. And therefore, focusing on environmental degradation must be the primary focus. Although in my table we did say there is definitely spots for looking at how we manage and maintain what trout and what sports fish we have where. And finally, my colleague back in Palmerston North asked me what the colloquial title for my talk was, and I didn't have one. So I just thought I'd hashtag it just to tweak his nose, really. Thank you so much for your time.
Well done, Amy. Thanks very much. Okay, so that's all five of our speakers today. I've got my colleague Kylie Hall here, who's got the microphone in the audience and will be roaming around in case anyone has any questions. But I might ask the five speakers to come and sit up the front here, if that's okay. So just as a bit of a summary, first we heard from Simon Weltersbach from the Institute of Baltic Sea Fisheries. He presented a case study on change points when monitoring Western cod, and he noted the importance of long-term monitoring programs. We then heard from the Ausfisch crew, Robbie Porter and his colleague, about their passion project in shellfish habitat restoration, or fish making machines as they call them. Crystal Beckmann from Sardi over there presented key findings from the 2021-22 South Australia Rec Fishing Survey, which is a huge project, and I'm sure there'll be questions on that one. Fourth, we had Kenneth Brennan, lead fish biologist from NOAA Fisheries, and he spoke about the strong electronic monitoring technologies and program and regulatory changes applied to the four higher fisheries in southern eastern US. And last but not least, we had Amy from Fish and Game New Zealand, who spoke about her thesis and impacts of introduced species on native fish populations. Okay. So I might hand over to you guys. Please raise your hand if you've got a question, and I'll try to take them in order, and I'll get Kylie to bring the microphone over to you.
Could we also please ask our beloved speakers, if you wouldn't mind when you're answering a question, if you could actually jump up to the lectern, please? That would be really helpful for the sound recording for the online. Thank you.
Thanks. Is this on? Yeah, okay. It's a question for Robbie regarding, I think it was in one of the keynotes, we heard about some of the permitting challenges that you're faced with, you know, implementing restoration projects. And I don't know if that's something that you deal with at your level with respect to that, but could you just give us a brief overview about how that impacts the work that you're doing?
Yep, it impacts completely. We work in Moreton Bay, which is a marine park, and there's no legislation and there's no word for restoration. So for us to put a reef back, it's the same as if we put an oil refinery in the bay. We have to go through that same process. We've got a basket shells. We want to put it there, or we want an oil refinery, put it there. It's the same development application. So it's crazy, but we're looking at ways to work around it. So we're lucky enough that the Port of Brisbane Authority are really backing our project. When they distributed the land for the Port of Brisbane, they did a lot of land reclamation, and they sectioned off that big area, which is outside the marine park. In one corner, they decided to cut the corner and not actually use that last piece of space because it would be affecting the water flows adversely to a bay that comes through. And so with public consultation, they decided not to. There's 19 hectares there. It's subtidal. It's between 3 and 5 metres deep. So we're able to put our reefs in there. It's not where you'd ever pick. It's right near sewage outflows. It's right near the huge amount of dirty water that comes out of the Brisbane River. But we're allowed to put it there, so we're in. And legends, like I meant to mention Dave here, who works tirelessly collecting our shells and doing so much other work, and he's got a project himself, which is fantastic. You know, we've got so many volunteers doing it, so we're really glad to have that. I don't want to take too much time, but the way that we're going forward now is we've had a working group that is saying that the risk of restoring shellfish reef is lower than the advantages that those reefs will produce, the ecological and social advantages. So that's really good, but again, it's stalled at a point where they've got to write legislation into the marine parks law, and it's stalling there. We have a native title holder, which is KIAC, Quandamooka Yungaburrabi Aboriginal Corporation, that own the land. And so we're actively talking to them, and it's a new space. Even the permitters don't know what to do when they say that. So they're really keen. The pearl oyster, the bintada, is delicious, and it's a really important sustenance for the Quandamooka people. And so they're really keen for us to put these reefs back. But it's a very, very slow and long process. So, yeah.
Okay, thanks, Robbie. Any other questions?
Hi. Amy, so my question goes to the conclusion that you drew, which was about, you know, the primary objective has to be about stream or environmental management and protection. So my question is, do you have an organisation like Ausfish in New Zealand to help you with that, with that problem?
I don't think we have anything quite as formidable, and I mean in the best way, as you guys. Like, honestly, all I see are blue shirts and you're all amazing. We do have small pockets of anglers who work really hard. We don't seem to have too much that's really cohesive at the moment. We've got a much smaller population base, so it's quite hard to overcome some of that inertia. We do have a lot of very concerned, and again, it's a lot of anglers who come to us and say, hey, what's going on? And just make sure we're doing as much as we can. So I honestly think, you know, it would be a brilliant import. Like, swap you for the possums.
We don't want them back either.
Oh, come on. Oh, I love your
possums.
We just had too many.
Hi there. This is for Amy as well. Sorry, this is more of a comment than anything else and probably not relevant, but I'll say it anyway. So salmon in other parts of the world are known to take what's called partial migration. So part of the population will migrate while the others stay behind. So that may be something to consider. You know, your prey species may get no reprieve because wherever they are, there's a salmon waiting. I don't know if you've considered any aspects of partial migration in your thesis.
We did look at it very briefly. I'm not sure, because salmon in New Zealand, we don't have a very strong salmon population. And they require a lot of help, and they are very, very restricted. So mostly what we're looking at is rainbow and brown trout. Brown trout in particular, quite widely distributed, and they are known to landlock. So again, quite a few of them don't go to sea at all. Some of them will go down to the ocean mouths and then feed up in preparation, come back upstream to spawn. Some will sea run and come back. Our rainbows don't tend to sea run. So we are very much aware that there's going to be a lot of places where there is just this constant thing, the pressure of the predation. However, we also do know that actually piscivory is a very minor part in most trout. Even the very big ones, it tends to be less than 10% of their diet. And most of that, we also need to really look about the fact our apex predator is the eel. So our species, all our native freshwater species are carnivorous. The big fish will eat the little ones. If we do manage to make it so that they are all much more abundant, that should release those pressure as well. So it's a massive issue, but no, absolutely, it's a good thing to think about.
No more questions for Amy. Okay, thanks, Amy. We've got about 6 minutes, so probably time for 2 or 3 more questions. Okay, Simon's got one.
Yeah, we can do it either way. I have one for Crystal. I'm wondering how your response rates developed over time, because we see in Germany that response rates drop a lot when we do these telephone surveys. So maybe you can tell us something about this.
Good question. So a major thing that's changed is the sampling frame availability. So our first surveys were designed using the white pages, which was our phone directory. And so that's no longer a suitable sampling frame. So we now purchase essentially a panel survey database from a market research agency. So we've definitely seen a big decline in response rates. And a lot of that is also due to the quality of the database that we now use. So lots of disconnections and just general apathy from people not wanting to take surveys because everyone gets lots of phone calls from market research agencies. So it just really highlights that, yeah, we're looking for more supplementary methods for the future to be able to boost up these probability-based surveys.
Thanks, Crystal. Anyone else? Otherwise, I might ask one. My question was for you, Kenneth. You spoke about electronic technologies and things like VMS and app reporting for charter boats or party boats, as you call them, the bigger ones. I was just wondering what the vibe and, I suppose, stakeholder feedback was like in terms of getting those regulatory changes over the line over in the US, or... Yeah, were there a lot of complaints from, I suppose, the operators not wanting that additional burden?
The charter boat fleet in general was supportive of implementing electronic reporting. Head boats were already doing it for many years, but charter boats lobbied the councils to get that passed. The majority, a lot of charter boat captains, there's always that 10 to 20% that don't want change or, you know, are holding out for some reason or another. But in general, they're supportive of it. And with the electronic technologies, it makes it more nimble for them. They provide us feedback if there's something that can be improved. So it is a put and take with the charter boat and head boat. It's evolving as technology evolves, but generally speaking, they were supportive. Now, when you have to badger them because they're not reporting, they're not quite as supportive, but we try and work with them. We don't automatically penalize them for not reporting. We try and collect the information as courteous as possible, unless they become egregious about not reporting.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, any more? All right, well, I think it's a couple minutes until lunchtime, so I might wrap up there and thank you all for joining us for this session on resource monitoring, and I offer one last round of applause for our five speakers today.